Hi, welcome to this basic walk around the video for those new in the fleet. There's another set of videos that goes a lot more into detail of what each equipment or each item is on this video, but we keep this video basic and we'll show you the minimum requirements to perform a walk around. So we start with the main entry door and check the three seals for any damage or cracks. Then you close the door handle and check the six locking pins if they are out. And you will also see a yellow and black striped flag through these windows here. Then make sure you open the door handle again. Now, if you do not do it, or a passenger accidentally opens it up a little bit, you will not be able to close the door. But because you want to close the door eventually, you want to make sure the handle is open now. Next, the three static ports, check if they are clear. The airway vane, check for free movement. And then the nose compartment. I already opened up the door to save some time. And one of the first things you want to do is to bleed the air pressure out of the nose wheel steering accumulator. And you do that by pressing this black button. Once depleted, you want to check the pressure with this table above. Now the left table is for the nose wheel steering, and the right table is for both the emergency gear blowdown bottle and the emergency brake bottle. Do make sure you check these gauges, because there's no cost message indicating if these bottles are empty. Also check if there's nothing loose or leaking in the whole nose compartment while you're there. It's also worthwhile checking the oxygen level already. Now, your colleague in the cockpit will check the MFD page, the summary page, to see the quantity of the oxygen. But here you got a double check. Now, keep in mind, the cockpit check is the system check, while this is just a bottle pressure. So when you close the panel, make sure you lock it. All the locks should be pointed upwards. And this is an easy way to know that all the locks in the aircraft are closed. So next, the pitot tube, and then you want to crawl under the nose and check if the linkage is over-centered and hitting the stop bolt on this side. Also check for any leakages in the back. These cables sometimes have a high pressure and sometimes have a little leakage on it. Then check this pitot tube and below it the oxygen blower disc and make sure it is green. You do not have to open up this side of the nose compartment, and you can go directly to the nose gear. Now, one of the things I like to point out, make sure if you leave the aircraft that you get the big rubber chocks. You do not want to have those small wooden chocks, because this aircraft is super sensitive for wind and it will go right over those chocks. Well, when we check the nose wheel, check for the uplock cylinders if they move freely, and check the taxi lights. And check the torque link. If you still have to center the torque link, make sure that the nose wheel steering accumulated pressure has no more air pressure in it, otherwise it's very difficult to move, and make sure you pull and push here to align. So do not pull and push on the taxi lights or anywhere else, just pull and push on the top part of the torque link. Next is the pitot static and the AOA vane. Again, check for any blockages and free movement. And below here you find three static ports. Again, check for any blockages. Then check the engine intake. This is a good position for a general overview of the engine. Make sure that no cracks or no bird strike impacts on the engine. And if you're refueling, especially if you fuel to the max, you want to check these pressure pre-check levers to see if the refueling actually stops. So you move each open, check the fuel truck is stopping the refueling at a certain point. You also hear the valves closing, and then you close the pre-check levers again and continue refueling. Right, once we are below here, you continue and check the fairing fence for any blockages and also any cracks in the antennas, because this is one of the first places that a bird strike might appear. And then you check the three fuel drains for leakages and check the two stall strips here. And then further down you got the seven boundary layer energizers. And they keep the air over the ailerons, so at low speed you can still turn. Also, check on top if the fuel cap is locked, and the key you can find in this plastic binder behind the captain's seat. Now below here, you want to check the fuel tank vent in that scoop and the tank pressure relief valve. Make sure they're unblocked. A good idea is to go to the edge of the wing and look under to see, first of all, the two louvers. Make sure that they are open in the right direction. And check if anything sticks out that should not be there. And this is a good way because you can see the whole underside of the wing. In this case, you see that the static line of the fuel truck is connected. This is the position you want to connect it to. Then check the static wicks. Now, maybe you already know, but two may be missing as long as the outer one is still there. And check the general condition of the ailerons and the speed brakes and the flaps. And then go down and check the four gear pins, the brake pins, and check for any tire damage or leakages here. And now here the four brake wear pins, officially you have to set the parking brake for it. But this is not really needed, as you can see in this picture. The only thing different with parking brake on and parking brake off is when it's off, it feels a little bit more flexible, the brake wear pin. But the distance is still the same. The hydraulic panel, you do not have to open up for a walk around. But you do want to check the tail cone air inlet scoop for any blockages. Now above here is your pre-cooler, and here are the engine drains. Check if no leakages there. And sometimes if you overfill the oil, it drains out here. Now talk about oil. Check the oil level of the engine. Best is to check it 15 minutes after engine shutdown. However, if it is a start of a day or walk around, you do want to check this and see if there's still some oil visible at the bottom. If you do not see anything anymore, you should top it off with an oil refill. Normally half a can per engine should be enough. And if it's visible, then make sure you fill it up, but do not go beyond the max black line. So there are two lines on the top. One is the black, one is the red. Red is the max. And you want to stay obviously below the max, so you fill it up until the black line. Then check the intakes and exhaust of the APU and the air cycle machine. And check the trim is set to -7.4, or ask your colleague to set it to -7.4. And what I do personally is I asked my colleague to turn on the exterior lights and do the trim to -7.4 setting, so that we have both things done. And you want to check the back side for the -7.4. Not the front side, the back side actually. Then check the static wicks and the louvers here. And then go inside the tail cone. And turn on the light. And check for any loose items, leakages, or anything obviously that is wrong in the tail cone. And sometimes when it rains, especially when the wind is hitting the air cycle machine exhaust, rain can enter this yellow pipe, and overnight it causes it to collect water and it starts to drain on the tail cone door. Now, this is allowed, however, after it has rained overnight, do open the door and drain the water. The new models have a drain line in this air cycle machine exhaust. So this is not a problem anymore. Now these two pipes, they actually warm the baggage compartment on the bottom. They do it a little bit because the left one is officially going to the cabin and the right one is going to the cockpit for warm air. But because the lines are under the baggage compartment, you do have a little bit of heating in the baggage compartment. Then I check the APU, the APU bay RAM air inlet, and check the 44 vortex generators. Now, if one of them is missing, it's easy to see, easy to spot because there's a green paint under it. Also check this side for the minus 7.4 trim and the static wicks and the louvers. Now, the static wicks should be 9 at the tail, 3 on each side. Here we can see the pre-cooler. Here the engine drains. And this is a good time to go into the cargo hold to check if everything is tied down and secured. Personally, I do not tie down the engine covers, but that is debatable. All right, now let's discuss what is the best way to tie down the equipment here. Now, first, let's look at what we have. There are 5 plastic boxes and normally 1 or 2 water boxes we have to tie down. Now the largest plastic box contains our spare glasses. Sometimes they also put our cutlery there. Sometimes they put the cutlery in a small box, like in this case. And the small box should normally only should contain the small alcohols we have on board. Now the smallest container, like in this case, we can actually fit that into this large box to save some space. Now the other two boxes, they contain all our drinks, the champagne, the wine bottles, Coca-Cola, you name it. And there's another box similar size, and that is the spare oil cans. And you want to make sure that there are 3 of them inside. If not, ask restock to fill them up back to 3 or 4. Now also, what we do is, not all crew, but most crew, they cut one of these Evian water bottles open, so we can actually fill the engine oil this way. And also use paper towel or an other white towel to avoid leakage or spillage. Now how to tie this all down? Well, the best way I could find is the following. You have these 2 connectors at the end of the compartment, as you can see here. And you want these 2 being the locks of 2 boxes, so not 3. So you can fit or 3 on the end or 2 boxes on the end. Now I like 2 because you have these 2 places to tie them down. And well, if you look at this picture, you can see how I do it. I basically click them onto the other 2 in front of here. Well, then use this right lock for the ladder and put the thick side of the ladder aft. And here a video of how I tie the ladder down. As you can see, there is some space in front and in the aft I put the ladder against the lock. So not on top, but against. And because I have some space in front, I can also put a snow brush behind here, and some of the aircraft also have a small ladder. Well, in my case, I'm 2 meters tall as a Dutch person, I don't have any trouble, but some people have trouble fitting or getting to the oil, so they need a small ladder. Anyway, there's plenty of room to put something behind the ladder here. The left lock I use to tie down our crew bags, and I normally put the engine covers on top, like this. Now the engine covers, just as a side note, you want to use when there's a freezing precipitation, you don't end up in the morning going to the aircraft and you cannot rotate the fence. And also, really worthwhile thinking about places like Morocco, when there's sand and dust flying around that might damage the engine. So when that's the case, you want to put them on. Otherwise, we don't use them. Well, actually, some crew use them to stand up and fill up the, or check the oil, and they stand up on this bag. Right, that completes the inside. So now let's go back outside. So here we want to check the main gear again, check the brake wiring pins, four of them again, first with two on top, and then two on the bottom, and also check for any wear and tear on the tires, and also any leakages you find here. These are, by the way, good chocks, rubber chocks. Right. Then we want to check the oil level here. As you can see, it's about 3 fingers thick. This is good. Check the flaps, air brakes, ailerons and aileron trim, static wicks. And again, like on the other side of the aircraft, look under the wing. Check for the two louvers, if they're open in the right direction and nothing sticking out. We got the boundary layer energizers. This one is locked. Check if the vent is open. This one is not blocked. And you continue over to the two stall strips. And I check the intake, no bird strikes or damage. And on top you have the ACM intake. Now check the three engine of the three fuel drains, and also want to check the fairing fans, and also make sure that the antenna has no cracks in them. While you're looking at the antenna, also look on top, see if the top antenna also has no cracks in it. Alright, and that completes the basic walk around of the Letter to the Aircraft. I hope you enjoyed this video. And we'll see you on the line.